let us start the today's topic for the PGA activity. It is the approach to the small lung biopsy. So what will be the our objectives behind learning the small biopsy approaches? It is basically to learn how to identify the different morphological features and the patterns of lung neoplasms in a needle core biopsy specimens, then to know the various challenges which are going to occur for the histological and the IHC analysis of that tissue samples, and to know the importance of the molecular testing in the lung cancer. The need behind doing the small biopsies for the detection is for the early detecting the lesions, so we can provide the earliest treatment for the same, and to perform the ancillary tests so as to detect the earliest the targetable mutations, so accordingly we can start the treatment. According to the updated NCCN guidelines, the tumor size feasible for the small biopsy is at least 6 mm for the subsolid nodule and 8 mm for the solid nodules. By radiological means, the solid nodule is the nodule which is having a 3 cm or a less than 3 cm in diameter. For the central lesions, we preferably use the transbronchial biopsies, whereas for the peripheral lesions, we will go for the CT-guided transthoracic biopsies. The small lung biopsies are the samples which are defined as the tissues which are obtained by the non-surgical technique that are 1 cm or less in the longest axis. There are various techniques which are used to obtain the small lung biopsies. These are the flexible fiber optic bronchoscopies, which is the standard procedure, then endobronchial biopsies by the rigid scope, cryobiopsies, navigational bronchoscopies, particularly when the lesion is deeply seated in the lung parenchyma, and the transthoracic core biopsies, which is a radiological procedure. Now, what are the different diseases that we can diagnose with the help of small lung biopsies? That will be divided into the two categories, as the endobronchial diseases and the parenchymal diseases. In the endobronchial diseases, the endobronchial tumors and the infectious and the other endobronchial diseases we can diagnose, whereas in parenchymal diseases, that will be divided into two categories, as a focal solid parenchymal lesions, which includes the lung mass metastatic diseases and the solitary pulmonary nodules, and the focal and diffuse infiltrative disease includes the granulomatous disease and the non-granulomatous disease. We are going to learn some basic lesions which can be diagnosed with the help of small lung biopsies. Before that, I would like to introduce in brief about the types of biopsies we go. The wedge biopsy is a gold standard procedure, but it is a complex one and invasive, but it is preferred whenever we are going to require the exam in the larger area of the lung parenchyma to reach a particular or the specific diagnosis, because it requires the splitting of the chest muscles and the resection of the ribs. Whereas the most commonly used biopsy is the transbronchial biopsy, which is widely used because along with the biopsy, we can collect the other samples like the bronchial brushing, washing, and the bronchoalveolar lavage, which will be useful for the ancillary test performance if the tissue biopsy is minimum. Then needle core biopsies are mostly preferred for the lesions which are located peripherally in the lung. Now, the new advances is the cryobiopsy. The cryobiopsies use the flexible freezing bronchoscopes, and the advantage is that we can collect a larger size tissue sample, around 15 millimeter square, as compared to the forceps based biopsies, which can give us the 5 millimeter square biopsy size. And also there are less chances of the crush artifact. Whichever the type of biopsy we can perform, but we require at least 3 biopsy cores per tumor, which should be taken from the different sites in the tumor. This one is the rapid onset evaluation, that is the ROSE protocol, which is particularly performed when a repeat biopsy is advised, because as it is an invasive procedure, if we want to test the adequacy of the sample, the rapid evaluation is done with the help of the imprint of the tissue biopsy. That is called as a rapid onset evaluation, that is the ROSE protocol. Now, after collecting the sample, the most important one is that the major tissue will be for the molecular pathology, whereas the half of the sample, that is less than half of the sample, will be used for the histopathology and the immunohistochemistry diagnosis purpose. The serial sectioning should not be done if you are going to suspect the malignancy, Because of the serial sectioning, you can lose the major tissue, so that will be lesser available for the further studies. So avoid this serial sectioning if we are going to suspect the malignancy. These are the different benign tumors in the lung. But as we can see, the major biopsy, percentage where we can get the small biopsies is mainly for the malignancies. So we will go for the malignant studies first. Initially, we actually divide the lung carcinomas as a small cell carcinomas and the non-small cell lung cancers. So this is the WHO 2015 classification of the lung tumor, but the newer one is going to launch. It is not yet launched. According to the 2015 WHO classification, we divide the lung carcinomas as adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, neuroendocrine, large cell carcinoma, adenosquamous, sarcomatoid, carcinosarcoma, pulmonary blastoma, and the other carcinomas which include the lymphoepithelioma like carcinoma and the NUT carcinoma. Based on the clinical implication, particularly the clinicians will just divide the case into the small cell carcinoma and the non-small cell carcinoma. The major features which can be helped to differentiate or to reach some diagnosis clinically is that the small cell carcinomas are the rapidly growing tumors and they will metastasize widely and early. And so the at the time of initial diagnosis, whereas the non-small cell carcinomas, they are slowly growing and of lesser stage at the time of diagnosis. The small cell carcinomas are the chemo and radiotherapy, they are responsive to the chemo and the radio. So they are not generally considered as a good surgical candidates, but for the non-small cell lung cancer, particularly as they detected in the earlier stages, that is lesser stage, so they are the good surgical candidates. In histology, according to the line of differentiation, we will simply divide the lung carcinomas based as bronchogenic carcinomas, which include the squamous cell, adenocarcinoma, large cell or anaplastic, and neuroendocrine, whereas the bronchial gland or the salivary type are the adenoid cystic, mucoepidermoid, epimyoepithelial carcinoma, and the mixed epithelial mesenchymal tumors as a carcinosarcoma and the pulmonary blastoma. So first we will see the squamous cell carcinoma. It is mostly associated with the smokers. It particularly arises centrally in the major bronchi and it spreads to the local hilar lymph nodes. In the gross examination, there will be the central necrosis more commonly seen as compared to the cavitation. The precursor lesions for the squamous cell carcinoma are the squamous metaplasia, which later goes to the dysplasia and carcinoma in situ and the invasive carcinoma. Previously, the squamous cell carcinoma was described as a non-keratinizing, keratinizing, and the basaloid. But the recent advances shows that it is classified into the papillary, clear cell, small cell, and the basaloid pattern. So here we can see this is the normal epithelium. Because of some smoking and the other irritants, it goes into the hyperplasia of the lining epithelium. And later on, it converts into the squamous metaplasia. In this, you can appreciate this is the tall columnar pseudostratified tall columnar lining epithelium, which has transferred into the squamous metaplasia because of the smoking related and the other carcinogenic factors. Here you can see the severe dysplasia that is affecting the more than 2/3 of the lining epithelium and resulting into the severe dysplasia. This is the gross picture of the small cell carcinoma. This is the central carcinoma and this is the peripheral. Here you can appreciate that this is the trachea, which is bifurcating into the bronchi, and it is arising peripherally along the hilar region. Here you can see that there will be the cystic areas will be seen and the hemorrhage or the necrosis may be seen on the cut surface, and predominantly it is cystic in nature. The characteristic feature on the microscopies are the intercellular bridges formation is there, intercellular bridging is there, and there is a characteristic keratin pearl formation you can see and the individual cell keratinization. Next one is the adenocarcinoma of the lung. As we have seen that small squamous cell carcinoma was commonly associated in a smokers, whereas the adenocarcinoma is most commonly seen in a non-smokers and in the females. Now, previously, there was a higher incidence of the squamous cell carcinoma, but now because of the ventilator filters use and the lesser content of the tobacco or the tar in the cigarette content, now there are the more widely incidences of the adenocarcinoma of the lung. Now, this adenocarcinoma of the lung has some precursor lesions. These are the atypical adenomatous hyperplasia, Then adenocarcinoma in situ, minimally invasive adenocarcinoma and the invasive adenocarcinoma. Out of that, we will see the differences and the one. This is the gross picture of the adenocarcinoma of the lung that are also in the centrally or the peripherally located one. And here they are well circumscribed, but they are encapsulated tumors. They will also show the necrosis and the hemorrhagic areas on a cut surface. Now, as per the recent advances, previously there was a term as a bronchoalveolar carcinoma, which is now replaced with the term adenocarcinoma in situ. And there are few variations. They have now newly introduced certain terminologies as a minimally invasive adenocarcinoma, then invasive adenocarcinoma with the lipidic component, and the invasive mucinous adenocarcinoma and the lipidic predominant adenocarcinoma. We will see the one by one. So these are the precursor lesions of the adenocarcinoma. First one is the how to differentiate these lesions. So basically it is based on the size of the lesion, then the stromal invasion, invasive component size, and the pleural parenchymal lymphovascular invasion and the necrosis. So first we will see the atypical adenomatous hyperplasia, where the size will be around the 5 mm or the less, and it shows a proliferation of the atypical pneumocytes along the sentry acinar alveoli with the minimal septal widening will be there, and it gives an hobnail appearance, and it can be the multifocal one. Whereas in case of the adenocarcinoma in situ that replaces the former bronchoalveolar carcinoma, it shows a localized 3 cm or the less lesser size neoplastic lesion, and it will also show the characteristic lipidic growth pattern that is along the existing alveolar wall. But there is also septal widening is there, but here the characteristic you will there will not be any evidence of the parenchymal, pleural or the lymphovascular invasion will be there, and it can be mucinous or the non-mucinous one. Whereas in minimally invasive adenocarcinoma, even if it is also 3 cm or less in a size with lipidic growth pattern, there will be association of the one or the more foci of invasion will be seen, which is of 5 mm or less in size. This is the difference. Secondly, there will be the stromal invasion will be there in the form of desmoplastic or the fibroblastic stroma invaded by the tumor nest or the acinar. But there will not be any invasion of the lymphovascular invasion, and there will not be any evidence of the tumor necrosis. In case of the invasive adenocarcinoma, the invasive component will be now more than 5 mm in size, and you will get the pleural and the lymphovascular invasion, and there will be the necrosis will be present. So actually the invasive and the invasive adenocarcinomas we have divided into the non-mucinous and the mucinous adenocarcinomas. First we will see the non-mucinous adenocarcinomas. In a non-mucinous adenocarcinomas, they are having the following subtypes as a lipidic predominant, acinar predominant, papillary, micropapillary, and the solid. We will see one by one in detail. So as you can see, this is the lipidic predominant adenocarcinoma. Here you can see that there is along the sentry acinar alveoli, there is a growth along the existing sentry acinar alveolar lining walls. So this is the lipidic predominant adenocarcinoma. And then this one is the lipidic but associated acinar component you can appreciate. There is a growth along the existing alveolar walls with minimal septal widening is there, and somewhat acinar pattern you can see in the form of glandular structures. This is the acinar component. Here you can appreciate in acinar component, most of the tumors will be arranged in a round to oval glands. With there will be centrally cystic space will be there, which may contain the mucin. And the cribriform arrangement in the acinar adenocarcinoma gives a clue that there is a chance of poor prognosis if the cribriform pattern is seen in the acinar adenocarcinoma. Now here, this is the papillary. Here you can appreciate this is the alveolar space where you are getting the papillary fronts are there. Along the fibrovascular core, you are seeing the tumor cell growth that can be appreciated over here. But there is no characteristic stromal invasion is there of the tumor cells. Whereas in micropapillary, here you can see that there is a rosette-like arrangement is there in the alveolar space, and there is a lack of the fibrovascular core. So tumor cells are arranged in a rosette form over here, and the micropapillary is having the poor prognosis because it is mostly shows the vascular and the stromal invasion. This one is the solid adenocarcinoma, where there is a you can get the squamous or the adenocarcinomatous changes. And as per the WHO, to say as it is having a 100% solid component, you should see at least presence of the intracellular mucin in more than or equal to 5 cells per 2 high power field. And that mucin presence should be confirmed with the help of the IHCs. As we have already seen that adenocarcinoma is divided into the mucinous and the non-mucinous. We have seen the non-mucinous adenocarcinomas. Now we will see the mucinous adenocarcinoma. The mucinous adenocarcinomas are again having the subtypes as a mucinous atypical adenomatous hyperplasia, mucinous adenocarcinoma in situ, mucinous minimally invasive adenocarcinoma, invasive mucinous adenocarcinoma, and the enteric fetal, and one more is their colloid one. So here you can appreciate this is the first of our precursor lesion, that is the atypical adenomatous hyperplasia, where there is a atypical proliferation is there of the type 2 pneumocytes is there along the pre-existing alveolar walls is there. That can be mistaken with the type 2 pneumocytic hyperplasia, but the adenomatous hyperplasia typical one will be having the more discrete lesions will be there. Now this one is the adenocarcinoma in situ, where we have already described these lesions how to differentiate. Here the size will be less than 3 cm or the equal to 3 cm, but there will not be any invasive foci will be seen over here. It can be mucinous or the non-mucinous. This one is the mucinous type. Here you can appreciate the intracellular mucin over here. This is the minimally invasive one, where you will see there is a foci of invasion will be present, but there will not be any evidence of the lymphovascular or the vascular invasion. This one is the invasive one, where you will get the more than 5 mm invasion will be seen in the lining epithelium, and there will be evidence of the lymphovascular invasion and as well as the necrotic areas will be seen. This is the enteric form of invasive mucinous adenocarcinoma that exactly resembles as that of the adenocarcinoma which is arising in the colon. And this is the fetal adenocarcinoma. Now this is called as a fetal adenocarcinoma because it resembles to the fetal lung. Particularly there is a complex glandular architecture is there. It shows a glycogen rich glandular epithelium which is seen, and that resembles to the pseudoglandular phase of the fetal lung. And there is having two subtypes are there of the fetal adenocarcinomas, as a low grade and a high grade. In a low grade, there will be the low grade nuclear ataxia. In case of the high grade, will be high grade nuclear ataxia. But the differentiating point mainly will be the morula formation, which will be seen in the low grade fetal adenocarcinoma, where there is a lack of the morula formation in case of the high grade fetal adenocarcinoma. That can be mistaken with the endometriosis, endometriotic carcinoma. But there will be lack of stroma, which is positive for the ER and the PR. Then next one is the small cell carcinoma. Now small cell carcinomas are the poorly differentiated one, and they arises from the neuroendocrine cells, which are called as the Kulczynski cells. There is a characteristic feature that these small cell carcinoma are centrally located masses, and that the more extension to the lung parenchyma. As they are produced from the neuroendocrine cells, we will be having the association with the or the manifestations in the form of Cushing syndrome, hypernatremia, and the Lambert-Eaton syndrome. There are the characteristic features of the microscopy of the small cell carcinoma. Here you can appreciate these are the small round to oval cells. I'm showing the small size is like they will be the size will be less than the three small lymphocytes. Small lymphocytes diameter. That much small size you can appreciate of the small cell carcinoma, and they will be showing a characteristic nuclear molding, and the necrosis will be seen. Here you can see the gross picture, which is showing a rounded area that resembles like an hilar lymph node area. Then next one is the large cell carcinoma. But as we have seen all that in the squamous cell carcinoma and adenocarcinoma, there were the precursor lesions. For the large cell carcinoma, we are not having any precursor lesions. It is an undifferentiated tumor which may show the squamous or the adenocarcinoma features. It is having a poor prognosis. Mostly it involves the left supraclavicular lymph node, which is called as a virtual lymph node. The patient mostly when advanced, then they will be presented with a malignant pleural and a pericardial effusion. There will be association of the syndromes with the Horner syndrome and the Pancoast tumor, that is the apical neoplasm when involved. Then, as per the recent advances, we classify the large cell carcinoma into the following subtypes. That is the large cell neuroendocrine tumor, which is classically gives the positive neuroendocrine markers like synaptophysin and the chromogranin. The second subtype is the undifferentiated carcinoma, which expresses the cytokeratin, but there will not be positivity with the neuroendocrine marker. So that will help to differentiate it from the neuroendocrine tumor. The basaloid carcinoma, it resembles the cutaneous form of cutaneous counterpart of it, whereas the lymphoepithelioma-like carcinoma will show characteristic syncytial growth pattern, and there will be association with the Epstein-Barr virus. Clear cell carcinoma will show the cells, as in the name, they are clear cells. So they will be show the cells with the prominent glycogen, which can contain the clear cytoplasm. And the another one is the large cell carcinoma with the rhabdoid differentiation. So here you can see, this is the rhabdoid differentiated large cell carcinoma picture, and this one is the clear cell one. Here you can appreciate the large cells are there with the pleomorphic giant. Pleomorphism is there, and there is a multinucleation you can see over here. And this is the clear cell one, where the glycogen is clear, cytoplasm you can appreciate. Next one is the neuroendocrine tumors. Now, actually, the neuroendocrine tumors we will divide into as per the grades, as a low grade, intermediate grade, and the high grade. As a typical carcinoid will be the low grade, whereas a typical will be the intermediate, and the small cell and the large cell neuroendocrine tumors will be in the high grade malignancy. They are particularly divided based on the three bases: the number of mitosis per millimeter, 2 mm², then presence or absence of the necrosis, and the Ki-67 activity. So here you can see the typical carcinoid is having the less than 2 per 2 mm² mitotic rate, whereas in atypical, the mitosis will be 2 to 10. In a small cell, it will be more than 10. And in case of the large cell neuroendocrine cells, neuroendocrine carcinoma, it will be more than 10 per 2 mm². Similarly, the Ki-67 activity will be less, in up to 5% in the typical carcinoid, whereas it will be up to 20% in the atypical, and 50 to 100% in a small cell carcinoma, whereas it will be more in case of the large cell neuroendocrine tumors. And definitely the characteristic feature is the necrosis that differentiates the typical from the atypical. In case of the atypical, you will see the necrosis. We will see in detail. So the low-grade neuroendocrine tumors, if we see the carcinoid typical and the atypical, the commonest feature, if we see that 20 to 40% are not smoking-related one, they can be seen in association with the main syndrome. They are associated with the neuroendocrine cell hyperplasia and the tumorlet formation. I will discuss what is meant by the tumorlet in the latter one. And they express the synaptophysin, chromogranin A, and the CD56 and the NAC. The necrosis will be seen only in case of the atypical carcinoid syndrome. But these we can't diagnose on the small lung biopsies. Only the squamous and the adenocarcinoma we can diagnose on the small lung biopsies. The high-grade neuroendocrine tumors will show the higher mitotic activity, as more than 11 mitotic figures per 10 high-power field. And we have to differentiate based on the ISC and the molecular genetics. Then the bronchial carcinoid. Now, as I have already discussed that typical carcinoid and atypical carcinoid, based on the necrosis and based on the mitotic activity, it will be helpful to differentiate the typical and the atypical carcinoid. The characteristic feature of the carcinoid histology is that you will see the nest of uniform cells, which are having the regular round nuclei and a characteristic salt and pepper chromatin. Whereas in case of the atypical carcinoid, there will be small cells, but large cells also be seen with the necrotic foci. So this is the gross picture where you can appreciate a spherical pale mass here shown as a carcinoid growing. And it may be the carcinoid syndrome may be sometimes associated with the carcinoid syndrome. Then here you can appreciate that there are the small and round cells are there with the salt and pepper chromatin appearance over there with the moderate amount of cytoplasm. The next one is the sarcomatoid carcinoma, which is having the three types, as a pleomorphic spindle cell and the giant cell. So basically on the small biopsies, or even there is no particular immunohistochemical marker has been developed for the diagnosis of the sarcomatoid carcinoma. Mostly the sarcomatoid carcinoma, they show the KRAS mutation, and there is a PD-L1 expression is higher in case of the sarcomatoid carcinoma. And here you can appreciate these three forms as a spindle cell, And this is the giant cell. Here you can see this one is the giant cell form. This is the spindle cell form. And this is the pleomorphic form. Then the metastatic tumors of the lung. We have to know about which are the other organs that can metastasize to the lung so as to differentiate the primary origin from the secondary origin. The breast, GI, renal cell, carcinomas, muscle, bone, skin, particularly via the lymphatogenous spread or the lymph node, they are seen to metastasize to the lung. But for this, we have to go for the IHC analysis to differentiate the primary from the secondary one. So in short, the immunohistochemistry is must to diagnose certain carcinomas, particularly in the small biopsy samples, and they include the small solid adenocarcinomas, then non-keratinizing squamous cell carcinomas, large cell carcinoma, neuroendocrine tumors, sarcomatoid carcinoma, mesothelioma, metastasis, and the lymphomas. This is the summary of the IHC markers which will be used for the adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, and the neuroendocrine carcinoma. As we all know, the neuroendocrine markers are the synaptophysin, chromogranin, the additional one are the cytokeratin 7, CD56, and CD57. The for the squamous cell carcinoma, the P40 is more specific or the good one to diagnose the squamous cell carcinoma as compared to the P63. The other helpful one is the cytokeratin 5 and 6 and the high molecular weight cytokeratins. For the adenocarcinoma, the most popular one is the TTF1, that is the thyroid transcription factor 1, and the napsin A. But napsin A is more preferable one than the TTF1, as TTF1 can be positive in the other conditions also. So in short, for the terminologies, for the after getting the small biopsies, how you can give the small as a diagnosis over the small biopsies. Whenever you are going to get the morphology, squamous cell pattern clearly present, and we will assign it as a squamous cell carcinoma. The non-small cell carcinoma favoring the squamous cell carcinoma will be considered when the morphology is supporting as a squamous cell pattern, but morphology is not supporting the squamous cell pattern, but it is showing the P63 or P40 positive stain, then you can diagnose or you can give the terminology as a non-small cell carcinoma favoring the squamous cell carcinoma. Similarly, the adenocarcinoma of the lung origin or the adenocarcinoma, if it is supporting the adenocarcinoma morphological patterns clearly, even if there is a positivity with the TTF1 or the napsin is not present, you can assign the term as an adenocarcinoma of the lung origin. But you are not getting the characteristic morphology on the morphological features in the slide, but it is supporting the TTF1 and the napsin A positive, then you can assign it as a non-small cell carcinoma favoring the adenocarcinoma of the lung origin. The morphological patterns are also supportive and the cytokeratin markers are positive, then you can surely assign it as a small cell carcinoma. Otherwise, the non-small cell carcinoma not otherwise specified, if no characteristic morphology describing the adeno or the squamous or the neuroendocrine is present, then you will label it as the non-small cell carcinoma not otherwise specified. Now, there are, as we have already discussed, that 2015 was the oldest version. Now the recent version is going to come, that is the recent WHO. So certain terminologies they are going to introduce, it will be like that we have been added in this. The newer entities they are going to introduce are the bronchiolar adenoma or the ciliated muconodular papillary tumor, then thoracic mass CA4 deficient undifferentiated tumor and the mesothelioma in situ. And the update they have given are the invasive non-mucinous adenocarcinoma differentiating grades, we will see that. Then the pleural peritoneal mesothelioma grading and the molecular markers and the lung neuroendocrine neoplasms. So first one is the thoracic mass CA4 deficient undifferentiated tumors. Now the mass CA4 inactivation defines a group of undifferentiated thoracic malignancies transcriptionally related to the BAF deficient sarcomas. BAF is what, that is the Brahma associated factor. A distinctive clinico-pathological entity that with the undifferentiated rhabdoid morphology and the aggressive behavior is seen. Now, these are all previously called as the SMARCA deficient sarcomas, and now they are also, or they are called as the SMARCA4 deficient thoracic sarcomatoid tumors. What are the characteristic clinico-pathological features of this thoracic SMARCA4 deficient undifferentiated tumor? First one, they are highly malignant undifferentiated tumor. And it typically involves the mediastinum, lung, and the hilum, pleura, chest wall invasion is also seen. The bulk tumor manifests presenting symptoms and common widespread mets. Mostly in a patients who are heavy smokers and a younger age group and male predominance is seen. The mutation is this mass CA4 mutation, which most commonly we get as a nonsense mutation or the frame shift mutation. The other mutations which can be seen associated with this mass CA4 deficient tumor are the T53, KRAS, STK11, and the NF1 and the KAP1. The differentials which include under this category will be the lymphoma, NUT carcinoma, germ cell tumor, neuroendocrine carcinoma, large cell carcinoma, melanoma, and the other carcinomas. The diagnostic criteria for this is essentially and the desirable criteria. For essential criteria, there should be presence of the appropriate histopathological features and there should be the loss of SMARCA CA4, that is the mutation should be seen by the IHC. Whereas the desirable criteria include the SMARCA CA2 loss by the IHCs and the other IHCs include the CD34, SALL4 and the SOX2. The median survival is around only 4 to 7 months. Now, as we have already discussed about the gradings, they have introduced a grading system for the adenocarcinomas, particularly the non-mucinous adenocarcinomas. Based on the predominant pattern, they have differentiated into the three categories, differentiation and the predominant pattern. So the grade 1 will be assigned if they are well differentiated and showing a lipidic predominant pattern, then that will be considered as a grade 1. Whereas moderately differentiated with SNR or the papillary pattern will be the 2, and poorly differentiated with presence of any pattern will be regarded as a grade 3. Another entity they have introduced is the mesotheliomine C2. The mesotheliomine C2 is nothing but a pre-invasive single layer surface proliferation of the neoplastic mesothelial cells. Clinically, it is a non-resolving pleural effusion will be there in individuals with a history of the heavy asbestos exposure, prior irradiation or the family predisposition may be seen. Histopathologically, you will see a single layer of the flat or the cuboidal with or without the minimal cytological urticaria and the blunt nuclear features will be there. There may be presence of the nucleolus or may not be there, but there will not be any mitosis. The differentials for this mesotheliomine C2 includes the atypical reactive mesothelial proliferation, well-differentiated papillary mesothelial tumor. The essential diagnostic criteria for this is that there should be MTAP loss by the IHC or the BAP loss should be present and the P16 homozygous deletion should be there with the proper clinical history associated with it. It may progress into the invasive reticular mesothelioma with risk up to 75%. Next one is the diffuse mesothelioma. This diffuse mesothelioma having the three subtypes as a epithelioid, sarcomatoid and the biphasic one. In epithelioid mesothelioma, you will get the different architectural patterns as the tubulopapillary, trabecular, adenomatoid, microcystic, micropapillary and the solid. Whereas the cytology features of this is the rhabdoid, deciduoid, small cell, signet ring, transitional, pleomorphic, lymphohistiocytoid. The stromal patterns are the fibrous and the mixoid, there are 2-1, whereas the sarcomatoid mesothelioma is the desmoplastic with heterologous differentiation, transitional, pleomorphic, and the lymphohistoid are the other subtypes. The grading is basically based on the urticaria, mitotic. Here you can see we have graded into the low and the high based on the nuclear urticaria, mitosis, and the necrosis. So in low, there will be the mild to moderate nuclear urticaria will be there. The number of mitosis per millimeter cube will be either less than or equal to 4 in case of the mild, and in case of the moderate, it will be the less than equal to 1, and there will not be presence of the necrosis. But for the high grade, there should be presence of the 2 to 4 mitosis in case of the moderate, and there should be presence of the necrosis. The IHC markers are again the BAP1 and the MTAP. In case of the fluorescent in situ hybridization, there will be presence of the CDKN2 and the P16 expression will be seen. Then the other, now after completing the major chunk of the malignancies, there are certain other conditions where you can diagnose with the help of the small lung biopsies, but we are not actually performed for these diseases. These include the airspace occupying diseases. So these are the conditions which are covered under the airspace occupying lesions as acute pneumonia. Then the BOOP means the bronchiolitis obliterans or the organizing pneumonia, diffuse alveolar damage, intraalveolar hemorrhage, pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, pulmonary edema, and the pneumoconiosis. So all the pneumonias are diagnosed with the help of small biopsies? No, definitely not. With the help of the clinical features and the X-ray findings, we will diagnose the pneumonia. So particularly the pneumonias which are not getting responded with the help of modified treatments and all. And if you are not going to get any particular compounding factor which is causing the pneumonia, At that time, you can go for the small lung biopsy so as to diagnose the acute pneumonias. So as we all know, in case of the acute pneumonias, there will be the presence of the fibrinopurulent exudate will be present in the interstitium as well as in the intraalveolar spaces, and the characteristic neutrophilic infiltrate will be seen in that case. Second one is the bronchiolitis obliterans or the organizing pneumonia. Now, in this, we will, the characteristic feature is that this is the polypoidal plug formation with the stop you can see. Here you can appreciate that there is a fibroblastic plug formation is there because of the increased fibroblastic proliferation, which will not be seen in case of the diffuse alveolar damage. So that one is the differentiating point between the bronchiolitis obliterans organizing pneumonia and the DAD one. There will not be any polypoidal growth or the stop formation you can see. And that should not be mistaken with the other terminology, that is the obliterative bronchiolitis, which is a small airway disease which comes as an early late complication in a transplant rejection patient. Now, the another component that we have to study is the diffuse alveolar damage, which is having the three phases as the exudative, proliferative, and the fibrotic. So, in the exudative phase, there will be you can appreciate that there is a edematous fluid is present abundantly in the interstitium as well as in the interstitium as well as in the alveolar lumens. Here you can appreciate there is a characteristic hyaline membrane formation is there, which is amorphous eosinophilic proteinaceous material which is found along the alveolar walls. And the third one, you will get the atypical type 2 pneumocyte proliferation will be seen in case of the exudative phase. Next one is the proliferative phase, where you will get the characteristic fibroblastic proliferation will be there in the interstitium also, and in along the alveolar walls you can appreciate, and that can go inside the alveolar spaces too. So along with that, there will be the fibroblastic plug formation will be there, but there will not be any polypoidal lesion with the stop as you can see in case of the bone. And third one, because of the type 2 pneumocyte hyperplasia which is occurring, that may land up into the squamous metaplasia. And third stage is the fibrotic phase of the diffuse alveolar damage, where you can appreciate that there is a deposition of the collagen, which is seen in the interstitial spaces as well as in the alveolar septas. Why it is important? Because the current pandemic which is going on, that is the SARS-CoV-2 infection, where we are getting the diffuse alveolar damage. Here you can see that this is the normal alveolar wall, which is the thin, or the alveolar septa, which is the thin, that helps to helps for the gaseous exchange, particularly the oxygen. But because of the diffuse alveolar damage, as you can see over here, there is a widening and thickening of the interalveolar septa with the hyaline membrane formation, which is making difficult gaseous exchange. So here you can appreciate in the early phase how much is the thickness of the interalveolar septa. Here is the lining epithelium of the alveoli, and here is the hyaline membrane formation. As the thickness is much and much increased in the late phase, there is more and more difficulty in the gaseous exchange, resulting into the hypoxia. As we all know that the diffuse alveolar damage is nothing but the abrupt onset of the hypoxia with bilateral pulmonary edema in absence of cardiogenic cause. So other manifestations that can be seen in case of this pandemic, that is in case of the corona, is that there will be the thickening of the intra-alveolar walls. You will get the expanded airspaces showing an emphysematous change over here. Along with that, there will be the atypical type 2 pneumocyte hyperplasia, as we can see in the diffuse alveolar damage. Protein exudates will be formed in the alveolar septas and alveolar lumen. And a characteristic one is the pulmonary thrombotic angiopathy, we can say. There is a fibrinoid microthrombi will be formed not only in the lung capillaries, but also in the other organs, which are leading to the coagulopathies. Other diseases we can diagnose is the interstitial lung diseases. This is the revised American Thoracic Society, European and the Respiratory Society classification of the idiopathic interstitial pneumonias. Not for all we perform the biopsies, but sometimes we can go for the diagnostic purpose. So this is, first we will learn the usual interstitial pneumonia. Here the characteristic feature is that there will be patchy fibrotic areas will be seen in the usual interstitial pneumonia, and there will be the honeycombing fibrosis will be seen. Whereas in case of non-specific interstitial pneumonia, there will be uniform fibrosis you can appreciate, and there are two variants are there. Cellular variant is there and a fibrotic variant is there. In case of the cellular variant, there will be the infiltration and inflammation will be there along the alveolar septa and the interstitium, particularly compromising the lymphocytes and the plasma cells. And as compared to the usual, the non-specific interstitial pneumonia is therefore having a better prognosis. Then after studying all the diseases, you should know what type of artifact you can commonly see or the non-specific findings that can come across while studying the small lung biopsy samples. So these are the pseudoatelectasis, then the fresh blood in the biopsy, and we will see the one by one. In case the pseudoatelectasis is the artifact which commonly seen because of the crushing or the compression of that tissue sample, which is taken with the help of the forceps. So with the gentle handling, you can minimize this artifact. Then second one, the corpuramation is seen in an old patient. It is a non-specific one. The other we will see. So here you can see these are the pigmented macrophages which are commonly seen in a smokers, and that should not be mistaken with the intraalveolar hemorrhage, where you will see the hemosiderin-laden macrophages in the alveolar spaces. Second one is the pseudolipioid artifact. So here you can appreciate this is actually an air space which is showing a characteristic globular appearance, which is seen similarly in case of the lipoid pneumonia. You will get a fat globule which will be surrounded by an interstitial septas, which will contain the foamy macrophages, multinucleated giant cells, and there will be presence of the vegetative material. So that should not be mistaken as a lipoid pneumonia. Then, as we have already seen under the carcinoid tumor leads can be seen, but that should not be considered as a carcinoid tumor, because these carcinoid tumor leads will be showing a growth of the carcinoid, growth of the neuroendocrine cell in the form of nests or the sheets along this bronchiolar epithelial lining. But the size will be less than 0.5 millimeter. If it is more than that, then you can think of the carcinoid one, because they will also show the round to oval cells, but there will not be any mitosis. They will, even though they show the salt and pepper chromatin appearance similar to that of carcinoid cells, but there will not be any presence of the necrosis or the mitosis one. But they will also show the positivity with the neuro endocrine markers like synaptophysin and the chromogranin. So based on the biopsy size and the overall overall study of the slide, and based on the size, you can differentiate the carcinoid tumors from the carcinoid. Another artifact is the minute meningothelial nodules, which is an incidental finding one. Initially, they were considered as a chemodectomas, but because of their characteristic appearance with the meningothelial cells, they are now considered as a minute meningothelial cells, where you can see the spindle-shaped cells are arranged in a nest. You can see in case of this meningothelial nodules. Another is the megakaryocytes. That is, what is the megakaryocytes? Here you can see this is the megakaryocyte, but after the radio and the chemo, sometimes you can mistaken that as they are chemo or the radio and the smudgy or typical cells are there. But as lung is the main vascular organ, sometimes this megakaryocyte can get trapped inside the pulmonary capillaries. So that should not be mistaken for the viral cytopathic effect, not for the atypical smudgy cells of the chemo and the radiotherapy induced one. So here you can see these are the asteroid bodies, which are not always associated with the sarcoidosis. They can be seen in other conditions also. Thank you.
Padmini?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you aware of cryobiopsy?
Yes, ma'am. Cryobiopsies are particularly done with the help of the flexible freezing bronchoscopes, and they are more preferred because they induce, they gives us the lesser crush artifact and gives us a larger size of the biopsy sample. Particularly around 15 millimeter square area tissue sample can be obtained with the help of cryobiopsies as compared to the forceps based biopsies, which can give the tissue sample of around 5 millimeter square areas.
Yeah, so since it causes less of artifacts, in which lesion you can advise cryobiopsy, in which it is advisable? Mainly it is done in which kind of biopsies? Mainly interstitial lung diseases, ILDs, because the crush biopsies, the crush artifacts can cause difficulty in reporting for interstitial lung disease. So mainly cryos are used for that. But any disadvantage of cryo biopsy?
Yes, ma'am. In cryo biopsies, in one set only along the bronchoscope, you have to insert the whole bronchoscope inside that lesion, and in one set only you can get that biopsy. After getting the biopsies through that canal, you can't just take out that needle. You have to take out that whole bronchoscope outside the lung. So.
Yeah, I know, but the issue is mainly with the bleeding, which occurs after biopsy, to control the bleeding. So that's the main concern. Okay?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
I have one question.
Yes,
ma'am. You talked about rows, ma'am. Protein rows, that is a repeat vaccine also.
Yes, ma'am.
So what procedure is used in those?
After taking the biopsy, we will do immediately the imprinting of the biopsy, and based on the imprint study, we will look for the adequacy of the sample. So if it is adequate when I am showing the proper morphology, then we can go ahead, or in the same setting we will go for the repeat biopsy.
One imprint you are doing the routine stage.
Yes.
Dr. Padmini, you have mentioned the pulmonary blastoma. Actually, that is a misnomer. It can be seen in young adult, and that you have described that sarcomatoid. It is a type of sarcomatoid carcinoma. And childhood tumor, true tumor, is a pleuropulmonary blastoma.
What are the prognostic factors in lung carcinoma?
These are based on the molecular study. Particularly, the EGFR mutation is there, or the KRAS mutation. Based on that, or the ULK mutation, we can go for the prognosis study. The EGFR mutation is having both the prognostic as well as the predictive importance, whereas the ULK mutation is having only the prognostic point. So, as the treatment is based on the molecular studies only, so we need to go for the molecular studies to know about the prognosis and the prediction.
So initial classification of non-small cell carcinoma and non-small cell carcinoma is not valid, do you mean?
It is valid, ma'am, but for the ultimate goal is to diagnose and to start the treatment. So the treatment will be based on which underlying mutation is present. So
if you divide into non-small cell and small cell, we will not treat the patient?
We will treat the patient, ma'am, but the characteristic targeted therapy point of view, we have to know the molecular genetic study of that type of lung cancer.
But all the carcinomas will have molecular genetic aberrations or alterations?
No, ma'am.
No, then? Because all the centers are not able to do the molecular study. So, when you get a biopsy, so your basic diagnostic approach will remain the same, no?
Yes.
Non-small cell carcinoma
and small cell.
Small cell and non-small. What is the reason? It is based on what? Two things, no? What are those two?
Morphological features.
Morphology and treatment. What is the treatment for small cell carcinoma? And what is the treatment for non-small cell? That is the basic difference in treatment. That's why two groups came into treatment.
For the non-small cell carcinoma, we can start with the tyrosine kinase inhibitors and
chemo.
Yes, ma'am.
So it's basically chemo versus surgery.
Yes, ma'am.
For
non-small cell carcinoma, they present us in the late stages and they quickly metastasize. So they are only chemotherapy and the radiotherapy will be more preferred for them, whereas non-small cell carcinoma, they can come to in the lesser stages at 1 and 2. So they more preferable for the resection first. They are the more good one for the surgical candidates. And according to the further study of the molecular genetic study, then we can decide whether the targeted treatment will be helpful for that patient or not.
It was a very good presentation. You have covered more or less everything. The non-industry, the intermittent, everything. Good.
Thank you, ma'am.